welcome back for our hymn histories. This is part number 6. We're going to be looking at John Newton this evening. When Bill Daigle, a modern hymn historian, was 10 years old, a childhood friend invited him to Sunday school. And it was there that he first heard of God's amazing grace. And through the Spirit's convicting power, was brought under its lasting power. So thus started another life, not understanding, but certainly enjoying the amazing grace of Christ the Lord. Sunday school is a very wonderful way to introduce children to the Lord. When there is not a Sunday school for a child to attend, there's a lot that's missed out. John Newton, as a little boy, learned this same truth and would give the world a song that has been around for over 220 years. So this is the story of how God's grace saved another soul and set the world singing. John Newton was born in London in the year of 1725 on July the 24th in Wapping, London. His father, John Sr., was a sea captain who commanded merchant ships in the Mediterranean trade. His mother, Elizabeth, was a devout Christian woman who, realizing that an illness that she had, tuberculosis, would take her within a short time, she taught her son to know the Bible at an early age. When John was 7, his mother died. He went to sea with his father when he was 11 and remained with him until John Sr. retired in 1742. And by the time he was 17, he was in the British Royal Navy on a man-of-war ship, the HMS Harwich. His naval service was to last only 5 years, but he attempted to desert. So I guess he didn't like that very well. He was captured, publicly flogged, and demoted. And we're not told what rank that he might have held before his demotion, but whatever it was severe. During all this time, John drifted far from the teachings of his mother. With each passing year, he sank deeper and deeper into the pit of sin. He requested to be placed in service of a slave ship, which then took him to Sierra Leone, which is West Africa. He became a virtual slave and servant of an English slave dealer who abused him. First, he was a sailor on a slave ship. Eventually, he was a captain, transporting slaves from Africa to ports where they could be sold for the best prices. Finally, one night, on a waterlogged ship, the slave ship Greyhound, on March the 10th in 1748, with the main mast broken in two, John Newton came face to face with the God of his childhood Bible learning. Then and there, John was saved from his darkest sins. He recorded in his journal, when all seemed lost, that he exclaimed, "Lord, have mercy upon us." He was startled by his own words. After 11 hours, the storm ended and the Greyhound survived. As the ship sailed home, he read the Bible and other Christian literature and accepted the doctrines of Christianity. He gave up his profanity, gambling, and drinking, but he continued to work in the slave trade. He later indicated that his true conversion did not happen until some time later. He said, "I was greatly deficient in many respects. I cannot consider myself to have been a believer in the full sense of the word until a considerable time later." So after returning to England, he obtained a position as first mate aboard the slave ship Brownlow. After 1750, he made three more voyages as captain of the slave ships. One, the Duke of Argyle in 1750, and the African in 1752 and 3, and in 1753 and 4. He tried to justify his work in the slave trade. Here are the reasons why that he tried to justify his continuation in the slave trade. He sought to improve the conditions for slaves. He ensured his crew treated slaves with gentleness and concern. It was a common practice to pack slaves so they could barely move, but Newton provided more space for them. It was also common to lose many slaves during the voyage, but he was able on one of his voyages to avoid losing a single slave. One of the few slave ship captains in history to do this. He held public worship services for his hardened crew every Sunday, and he encouraged prayer. I can only imagine his life aboard these slave ships. From what I have read, these slave ships were filthy. They were disease-ridden. The slaves were not given adequate food and water, and that was the reason many of them died. Add to that, any of them that tried to rebel or resist against the ship's crew, they're liable to be killed and then thrown overboard, or thrown overboard without being killed. I guess John Newton felt like that he would be justified in continuing what he was doing if he tried, as an insider, if you will, to change things. Make things better. He gave up slave trading in 1754 after suffering a minor stroke. He said, "I had often prayed that the Lord in his own time would be pleased to place me in a more humane calling. I longed to be freed from these long separations from home, which were often hard to bear. My prayers were now answered, though in a way I little expected." Most of the time, God answers prayers in his own way, and usually not the way that we expect for it to be. So John's life was then changed forever. He abandoned the sea, he settled in Liverpool, and he married Mary Catlett. From 1755 to 1764, he served as the official tide surveyor. I'm not sure what a tide surveyor did. Maybe kept records of the high tides and low tides. I don't know. What information that I could find on that. He came to admire John Wesley and George Whitefield. Their influence helped him to decide to be a minister. Soon, John felt God's call on his life to preach, and preach he did. In 1764, he was ordained in the Church of England and secured an appointment to the parish church in Olney, England. He was the pastor there from 1764 until 1779. In addition to preaching at his church, he often held services in other buildings and talked about his early life and his conversion experience. He desired to sing hymns that expressed the simple, heartfelt faith of his preaching. He could not find enough available hymns for this purpose, so he began to write his own. Assisted by William Cowper, he produced the Olney Hymns hymnal in 1779. He wrote 282 of the 349 hymns in the hymnal. He wrote that the purpose of the hymnal was, quote, "a desire to promote the faith and comfort of sincere Christians." William Cowper, you will see his name popping up frequently in music. His name occurs frequently in the 1700s. So this will probably not be the last time that you'll hear me talk about the man William Cowper. To add a special touch to his messages, John would close with a poetic verse that he would compose. So on a Sunday morning in 1779, Pastor Newton closed his heartwarming message with an original poem about God's grace, or as John called it, His Amazing Grace. Somewhere around 1780, after becoming the pastor of the St. Mary Woolnoth Church in London, John Newton became an abolitionist. And by the way, he spent the remainder of his life, 28 years, at this church. His view of the slave trade had changed. He became convinced that it was immoral and ashamed of his role in it. In 1785, he began delivering sermons condemning slavery, even when no political party would touch the subject. In 1787, he wrote a tract supporting abolition called Thoughts Upon the African Slave Trade, where he described the groans and agonies and blood of the poor Africans. In 1789, he spoke to the Privy Council, that was an advisory group to the monarch, which included the Prime Minister. He spoke to the Privy Council on the evils of slavery. His Journal of a Slave Trader, Thoughts Upon the African Slave Trade, and his autobiography comprised the most detailed records of the slave trade. Historians credit John Newton for much of what is known about the 18th century slave trade. Now we look at another man. How many of you, if any, have seen the movie Amazing Grace? That is the story of William Wilberforce. William Wilberforce was a British politician and leader of the movement to abolish the slave trade. Wilberforce found John Newton's anti-slavery sermons life-changing. Wilberforce himself had recently been saved and considered leaving politics for Christian ministry. Newton encouraged Wilberforce to stay in the Parliament and, quote, serve God where he was rather than enter the ministry. And that was probably a very wise advice and a wise decision on Wilberforce's part in taking Newton's advice. Without that happening, who knows how much longer that the slave trade could have continued. Wilberforce spent the next 20 years working towards the abolition of the slave trade in the British Empire. The British Parliament finally abolished slavery the same year John Newton died, 1807. In 1807, John Newton wrote these words shortly before he died. Quote, my memory is nearly gone, but I remember two things, that I am a great sinner and that Christ is a great Savior. Let's turn our attention now to the hymn that John Newton wrote, Amazing Grace. The original title was Faith's Review and Expectation. It was based on 1 Chronicles 17, verses 16 and 17, a prayer of King David in which he marvels at God's choosing him and his house. It originally consisted of six stanzas. He did not write the music for the hymn. He was another hymn writer who did not write music for any of the hymns that he wrote. Someone else wrote the music. The hymn became more established in America than in England. It was set to the tune of an early American folk melody, first known as a plantation melody entitled Loving Lambs, and that was from 1831. The final verse was substituted for the last verse and started with, when we've been there 10,000 years. It's unknown who wrote that last stanza. The musical arrangement that we have in our hymnals was done by Edward O. Excel in 1900. Now let's listen to Amazing Grace as it's sung a cappella by the Kleinwood Church of Christ in Allen, Texas. Amazing Grace. Amazing Grace has been recorded and played and sung and listened to innumerable times, and it never gets old. One of my favorite renditions of Amazing Grace is the Scottish bagpipes. I really like that one. But for the purposes of what we have here, I would have run into copyright problems probably if I had got something from them. There is a method to my madness in selecting the songs here, and that is the songs themselves are in public domain, but not always can I use something because the singer may have had it recorded and put a copyright on it. So I have to be very careful in what I do. These a cappella sings, these annual sings that these churches of Christ do, the ones that I'm working with, the songs that I'm working with, are public domain, and so they do not copyright what they are singing. And I also get congregations like the Temple Baptist Church in Powell, Tennessee, and also the Cleveland Baptist Church in Cleveland, Tennessee. Those are large churches who have a lot of congregational singing, and that's not copyrighted either. So I can draw those songs and be able to use them freely without having problems. Now, there's one other hymn by John Newton that is in our hymnal, In Spirit and in Truth. He wrote this hymn also in 1779, the same year that he wrote Amazing Grace. The tune came from an Austrian hymn and was arranged by Franz Joseph Haydn in 1779. 98. Now let's listen to "Glorious Things of Thee Are Spoken," as sung by the Cleveland Baptist Church in Cleveland, Tennessee.
Amen. Let's all sing out now, nice and loud, on the first, "Glorious Things of Thee Are Spoken."
Glorious things of Thee are spoken, Zion City of our God.
Sing it out nice and loud on the last.
Round the cabin.
That was one that we don't sing here. I was not familiar with it before I started this study. So always when we think of John Newton, we always think of Amazing Grace. But he wrote many more hymns. But sad to say, all that we have are just these two. So the next hymn writer that we're going to look at and at the next time will be Fanny Crosby. And be ready to listen to a lot.